foam rollers and cryotherapy and icing and all the stuff that is marketed to athletes and things that they're supposed to do. And I kind of look at the science and whether any of it holds up. But really, this is a science book masquerading as like a self-helpy like sports book. It's really a book about the scientific method, the scientific process, how we know what we know, and how science is sort of misused or abused to market things to people. And as I go through the talk, you'll sort of understand. I'm going to kind of walk you through the evolution of my thinking on this, which I just want to say was very deeply influenced by my time here at SFI. And in fact, when I was putting together this talk, I realized, wow, so many things and so many ideas that I have, and like my thinking on so many of these issues was so deeply informed by my time here and being here and sort of interacting with and talking with so many different researchers from such a wide variety of fields, and in many cases, people that I wouldn't normally encounter in my normal reporting. So it was really, it just made me understand and recognize and cherish what a wonderful time I had here and how influential, in a really good way, it has been. So the book came out in February. I'm just getting to the end of my book tour. You can probably hear I'm fighting the end of a bad cold, so forgive me if I start coughing. Anyway, but my obsession with the scientific method and with statistics and all of this stuff, and almost kind of the genesis of my book, began here. This is the Garfield Grumble. It's a 5 mile trail run, which, the first time I did it, I saw a little notice in the paper that said 5 mile trail run. I thought, oh, that sounds easy. Little did I know, it climbs 2,000 feet in 2 miles. This is the very start of the race. It's the kind of run that like using your hands helps. It then drops down the other side of the mountain very steeply. This is the finish line, which is a fire pit. You have to jump over it in order to finish. And then at the end, this is Mount Garfield at the top there. We've run up and over it. At the end, we all stand around drinking beer, which is a wonderful, refreshing post-race beverage. But I started to think, does drinking beer really, is this really such a good idea? I think alcohol is a little bit like coffee, like it's mind-altering and pleasant. And so we sort of suspect that it's bad for us, even as we really hope that it's good for us, right? And so I thought, okay, yeah, I'm a science journalist by vocation. I went to the scientific literature, took a look around, but I didn't find any satisfying answers. Most of the research that had been done on alcohol and athleticism was done in like rugby players, where they actually like gave them alcohol to do during. Like actually during exercise, which is not the scenario that I'm looking at. Or there were studies where they were, again, it was a lot of rugby players for some reason, but also weightlifters, where they were giving them an incredible amount, the equivalent of like 6 or 7 beers. And that is not the scenario I'm talking about. I'm talking about one refreshing beer after a hot run. So I started off as a scientist. I'm still sort of an experimentalist by nature. So I said, hey, let's do a study. I roped in my friend Gig Ledbetter, who at that time was running the exercise lab at Colorado Mesa University in Grand Junction, which is my local university there. And so we put together a study. And we did this, to the best of our ability, really thought long and hard. Look, they were the scientists. I was sort of the helper journalist, but I was involved in the process, and I really felt like we were doing our best to answer this question, which seems like a pretty easy, simple question, right? So we put together a protocol. We had 10 volunteers, 5 women and 5 men. The first part was the beer run. So basically, everyone ran on the treadmill for 45 minutes, 75% of their VO2 max. This test or this run was really designed to be fatiguing. So it's hard enough that you can talk, but you're sort of like incomplete sentences. And so it's not all out, but it's hard enough that you're going to feel it the next day. And that was important because we're trying to measure recovery. After the beer run, everyone got fed a nice pasta dinner along with a beer. And this was a double-blind, placebo-controlled trial. So we had a placebo beer. Everyone did the protocol twice. So you got the placebo beer one time and the real beer, a very fine Colorado fat tire amber ale. The other beer was chosen for it sort of looked very similar in the plastic cup to the other one. That was kind of its most redeeming quality. Anyway, but we were getting people up to, we actually gave them breathalyzer tests beforehand to get just below the legal limit to drive in Colorado. So this was not, people were not like falling down drunk. This was like one or in some cases two beers. So part two, that everyone came in the next morning and did what's called a run to exhaustion. This is a really standard test that's used in sports science to measure a lot of different things. And basically, people are put on the treadmill at 80% of your max, and then you have to go as long as you can until basically you cannot keep going. It's really, I can tell you, so I was not only a designer of the study, I was also a participant, which is really important because I learned a lot of the lessons that I learned were because I was a participant in the study. So basically, 80% is like pretty hard. It's too hard to like be talking, to really be having a conversation, but it's not all out. So it's kind of like, I personally found it sort of really uncomfortable because you're not all out, but you're not really going that easy either. So it's kind of that uncomfortable, like almost like threshold sort of pace, if that makes any sense. So and I'll get to this in a minute, but someone had asked at the beginning of the study, we briefed everyone beforehand, how long should I expect to last on this? And the answer was about 20 minutes. So if that gives you, and that's, you know, sort of how long you can go at this. So then we had beer again, come in the next day for run to exhaustion number two. And this was sort of, so, you know, half the people got the placebo beer the first night, half got the other, and then you switched. And there was just one undergraduate researcher who poured the beer who knew who got what. No one else knew, and, you know, we blinded that until the very end when they were doing the analysis. So here's our hypothesis, that these were the three things that we were measuring that we thought beer might alter. This was sort of based on what was known too. The first was ratings of perceived exertion. This is really the most basic. I mean, honestly, this is probably the thing you care about the most. This is how you feel. Like, this is like, does it hurt? How bad does it hurt? And there's actually an established scale for doing this. Respiratory exchange ratios. This is a measure of fuel usage. So one hypothesis was that alcohol may be affecting what kind of fuel you're using later, you know, the next day, maybe more carbs or more fat, something like that. There may be a gender difference there. I'll get to that in a minute. And then the third thing was time to reach the exhaustion point. So this is like, how long are you lasting? If your recovery was really impaired, you'd expect that you would, you know, give out a lot sooner on the exhaustion test. So when we analyzed all the data, it turned out that we found no differences in the first two measures, but we did find a statistically significant difference in the time to the exhaustion point. And here were the results. So women actually were able to run 22% longer on average after having the beer. We had a p-value of 0.03, and so I'm gonna get into that in a second, but that basically, when your p-value gets under 0.05, the angels sing, you can publish your paper and like a nice journal. This is like kind of established scientific protocol here, that a p-value of 0.05 or less means that, you know, it's a good study. And like I said, I'll talk about that in a little bit more. But it's interesting, some men did 21% worse. That wasn't statistically significant, so we couldn't really say that that was a meaningful difference necessarily. But I have to say, if you're like me, you're a beer-drinking woman married to a guy, like, this is awesome, right? If this was like science speaking, I could say, sorry, honey, I'm the drinker, you're the designated driver, this is science, like, this is how it all went. So, yeah, really sexy, enticing study. This is like headline-making material, right? I mean, this is the kind of stuff that newspapers and magazines love. There was only one problem, and that is I just totally did not believe the result. And let me tell you why. This goes back to me being a participant in the study. In retrospect, I realized, wait a second, I don't really think we're measuring what I care about here. You know, remember, my initial question was, you know, is beer gonna wreck my recovery? Am I gonna feel lousy the next day if I have a beer after my run here? And, you know, this run to exhaustion is unlike anything that we ever do in real life, at least unless you're on some like reality show or something. I'm sure there's a scenario out there somewhere, but it's not really a test that measures something that we care about in normal athletic. You know, it's not a time trial performance or something like that. But the other thing is, and this wasn't just me, after we were all said and done, I interviewed all the other participants, and every single one sort of said the same thing, that this run to exhaustion, which, by the way, is a very established test, like, we never gave it any thought when we were putting the study together, because it's just established, this is what people do, it's established protocol, never gave it a second thought. But as a participant, I felt like, this isn't really measuring like some sort of physiological thing, this is measuring how dedicated I am to the study, like, how long am I gonna take this crappy thing? Because it was unpleasant. Like, you know, this run to exhaustion, it sort of felt like, I kept feeling like I wanted to just do, you know, like that end spurt, like I'm just gonna use up the rest and be done, but no, I'm still stuck at this stupid pace. And so it really felt like a measure of mental tenacity. And let me say, that's an important part of, you know, that is part of what goes into how you're feeling. And so I'm not saying that it's absolutely worthless, but I think that at the end of the day, what all of us who were participants in the study felt like, that it just wasn't really measuring the thing that we cared about. But I also want to point you to, this is Larry sitting here with his daughter in the lab. And, you know, talking to him, he had the real beer for the first day and the other one the second, and his the placebo beer, which was it? Anyway, so he performed better after having the placebo beer. Well, it turns out that on that run to exhaustion, his daughter had come with him to the lab, and she was getting kind of cranky and tired. And he said, yeah, I probably could have lasted longer, but she was here, you know. So there are these external factors that can really exert a big influence on how people are performing. And, you know, one of the things is this is why you have, like, multiple people in the groups and things like this. But remember, we only had 10 people. We had 5 people per arm. And when I'm thinking about this, I'm thinking, yeah, this is sort of the beginning of my journey on all this. And I thought, well, this is just a crappy little study. It's very small. But as I was researching my book, what I found is that studies of 10 people are really, really common in the sports science field, like surprisingly common. And I think what I'm learning here is that, you know, this it's really hard to get a reliable result when you're testing such small study groups. And there's actually good evidence of this. There have been some studies looking at this. So it is harder to get a good p-value when you have small groups, but if you get a statistically significant result, it's more likely to actually be spurious or to not replicate. And there are some reasons for that I won't go into now. There was a really interesting study done with psychologists that were looking at this, where it's basically like you can do 20 small studies and you're more likely to get a significant result than doing one really large study. So it's really like the more you try and the more different things that you test, the more likely you are to get an answer that you like. So another lesson was that study design really matters. They were all very well trained. So we had some, I can't remember what the entrance criteria was, but it was like you had to be running a certain number of miles per week, and they were all people that were racing, at least recreationally. So not everyone, they weren't necessarily elite, but they were very serious. Well, that's another good question. How applicable is it? I want to try and hold the questions to the end if we can, because I have a lot to go over. If you have something really dire, please feel free. But so study design really matters. We had a really good reason for doing it the way we did, where it was to like basically a whole weekend where people were doing things stacked up. But this is Marty. He's an ultra runner, and he went an incredibly long time on the first run to exhaustion. I mean, it was like an hour and a half where other people were going like 20, 25 minutes. And this is important because he got the placebo beer the first day, and so he got the real beer the second day. And so was he tired and not feeling good the next day because of the beer, or was it because he ran so long the first day? Really hard to say. And, you know, if we did it again, I think we would separate that out. But, you know, sometimes in practical terms, it isn't possible to do everything perfectly. But these things can really exert a huge influence on the results that you get. Another important thing is that the participants' expectations of things are really important. Like I said, at the initial meeting, people had asked, you know, this run to exhaustion, how long should we expect to go? Gig told us 20 minutes. Well, it turns out every single person who'd been at that meeting was looking at the clock and said, okay, I have to go at least 20 minutes. And that was sort of like, at that point, they sort of had permission, and then they could start asking themselves, do I still feel like going? But so what's really interesting is there were two people who had missed that meeting, and so they got private briefings, were not told this information, and neither of them made it 20 minutes. They were like 12 minutes and something like that. So it's a significant thing. But the other important thing, and this is something I ran into again and again when I was looking at studies for my book, is that, you know, we were a placebo-controlled study, but it wasn't really a placebo-controlled study because no one was really fooled by the placebo beer. In fact, Larry even told me, he's like, I know exactly what that is. It's an O'Doul's Amber. You know, he was trying to qualify for Boston one year, and he gave up alcohol, and it didn't help. So he went back, but he had tried all of them, and so he even knew. But anyway, but this can really, you know, influence what you're getting, and I saw this a lot, particularly in things like icing, massage, I mean, where it's just very difficult to have a real placebo that's going to eliminate this thing that you're trying to address with the placebo control. Another really important lesson is that, you know, I was totally primed to believe this result, right? And if I had been maybe a less skeptical person or you know, whatever, I might have been like, yeah, this is the answer, and we really know it. But we're all, like, science is done by humans who all have things that we want to believe. And oftentimes when you're doing a study, it's because you already have a hunch and you already have some reason to be testing that. And so you're sort of primed to believe whatever you're going to be finding. And so it's really important to just ask yourself, how could I be wrong? You know, what are the strengths, but also what are the weaknesses here? As a journalist, that's something I always ask scientists when I'm interviewing them about their work. You know, how could you be wrong? You know, what are you the least certain of? And I'll tell you what, when someone balks at that, I think, oh no, like you're doing it wrong. If you're not already thinking about this, you're really missing some important nuance here and an important thing to think about. And so I want to get to, so this beer and running thing really started my, like, I guess from there on out, like, obsession with p-values and statistics and methodology, which is like really geeky stuff, but like what I found out from the beer study is that it really, really matters. And it's stuff that should not be ignored. I used to, when I got a scientific paper, I'd read the abstract first. Now I read the methods first because the methods really matter. And if the methods are bad or they're off, like the conclusions don't, it doesn't mean anything, because if they're measuring the wrong thing or if their statistical methods are bad, you really can't make heads or tails of it. And so the problem here is that p-values have become, in a lot of fields, and this is not universal, but it's very widespread, they've become almost sort of a de facto like measure of truth, but that's not what p-values are. And in fact, I had a lot of fun. I went to this meta science conference and I asked people there, so these are like experts on this stuff, and I had a video camera and I said, just explain in a sentence to me what a p-value is. And this is what, I mean, they're just like, it's hilarious. We have a little video you can watch online about this. But like even experts, even scientists cannot explain this because it's really technical, it's hard. But the bottom line is, and the American Statistical Association got so fed up with this that they actually put out a statement in, what was it, 2016, saying, you know, hey guys, stop misusing p-values. Because this is something that has really led to an almost sort of crisis in science in a lot of fields. Psychology is one that's been talked about and thought about a whole lot, but also clinical medicine, oncology, and there's kind of been this recognition that we have this whole body of research that is irreproducible and that we've sort of been going down the wrong path with things. And a lot of this, it's not only an over-reliance on p-values or misusing p-values, it's also some of this methodology stuff and sort of collecting a lot of data and then fishing around until you find something interesting in this. There's all kinds of things, and people are starting to talk about this now. But p-values are an important part of this. And I think that one of the most important things that I learned, and I see this all the time now as a journalist when I'm talking to scientists, is people have really come to think of p-values as a measure of truth, and they're not. They just aren't. They can't tell you whether it happened by chance. They can't tell you whether the finding is true. They can't tell you, you know, whether it's going to stand up. But people regularly, and scientists will tell me that, and I'll say, no, wait, you're wrong. And it's interesting, when I wrote that piece about even scientists can't explain p-values, I got all these emails from people saying, oh yeah, actually you're wrong, it's really easy, and then the definition they would give me would be completely wrong. And so that was really interesting. Anyway, I really wanted to write about this, and actually I was thinking about this a lot when I was on my fellowship here, and probably talked to some of you in the room about this. Seeing a lot of friendly faces here, thank you for coming. So what I decided is, this is really sort of technical, difficult stuff. The only way to really explain it, particularly to a lay audience, is to let them do it themselves. So what we did at 538 is we put together this p-hacking interactive. So this was a scenario: you're a social scientist who has a hunch that the US economy is affected by which political party is in office. We actually took actual data sets. This is a real thing. This isn't some like made up scenario. And then we let people go in there, be the scientists. And so of course, you know, you come into this first initial problem that every scientist has, which is, okay, what are you looking at? How are you going to measure the thing that you're interested in? And this measurement problem is really, really important. And I think this interactive was really a good way for people to understand this. What do you mean by political party? Is it presidents, governors, senators, representatives? So we had all these things that people could choose. How do you measure the economic performance? Is it employment, inflation, GDP, stock prices? You know, and there are all these other little things you could factor in. Well, based on this, so then people could choose things, and then we would spit out what the relationship was, what the p-value was. And what it turned out is, in this scenario, there are 1,800 possible combinations, and 1,078 of them yielded p-values of 0.05 or less. So that means that basically you could take this data sets and like say anything you wanted to about that. I think that's a really important insight. And I'm not saying, you were able to say whatever. I'm not saying that science is terrible and scientists are always intending to do this, but I think they need to realize that p-values are not like the main tool. They need to really become a little more skeptical. And I also just want to say something about my role as a journalist. So as a journalist, it is not my job to be a booster of science. I'm not here to like promote science, although I love science and I you know, I have confidence in it and all of that. But it's really, you know, I am covering science in the same way I might cover politics if I was a political reporter. And I think that that's important. And I'll get to some reasons why in a moment. But a really important lesson that came out of all of this is that it's a lot easier to get a result than it is to get an answer. And so often now when I'm looking at studies and talking to scientists, I'm thinking, okay, so you got this result and it's interesting, but where does it really fit? And the question that you really care about, what is it? You know, it's science is really an iterative process. It's a way of sort of reducing the uncertainty about all these things that you're looking at. And so one study can only answer a very, very narrow set of questions. You know, for these 10 runners on this day with this beer under these conditions, how did they feel? And the question is, like, is that result generalizable to, you know, someone at the Garfield Grumble drinking a beer and wanting to go for a long run the next day? And sometimes the answer is we don't really know. So out of all of this, so that p-value interactive was part of the story I wrote called Science Isn't Broken. It's just a hell of a lot harder than we give it credit for. And this was something that I really was thinking a lot about when I was here at SFI, just how we're thinking about science and sort of people's expectations of it and why we've gotten to this point, you know, where we're having this. Psychology is a field that's really been grappling with this, and I think that they've actually, I wrote this story about sort of the work that's been done here and sort of concluding that a lot of this has actually made the field stronger. And so if you think of science as like, oh, they made a mistake and they recognize a mistake, that means that science is broken and it's all terrible. I think you're looking at it the wrong way. I mean, science is a self-correcting process. It's often wrong on the way to being right. And so when it's correcting itself like this, that's getting better and that's part of the process. If that's science working, it's not a sign that science is unreliable. It's quite the contrary. But this is something that psychology has really been grappling with. I think they've done a pretty good job of, you know, introspection. It's been very controversial, though, and it hasn't been without bumps. And yeah, there aren't easy answers here. But what I found out, so I had been reporting on this in psychology, and like I said, there's a lot of stuff going on in clinical medicine and things like that, too, about this. But as I was reporting my book, I kept seeing these same issues. I mean, like literally the exact same issues that were being talked about in psychology as problems. So small sample sizes, over-reliance on p-values, something called harking, so it's like hypothesizing after results are known, I think, you know, taking so many different samples, you know, like basically dividing things into groups until you got a p-value that you like, so p-hacking and things like that. I was seeing it all over sports science, but no one was talking about it. And these things that, you know, at one point were acceptable in psychology are no longer really acceptable. In sports science, were totally acceptable. And as I was looking at other fields of science, what I saw was that there's this cultural aspect to how science is done that's really important and really influential. And this varies a lot across different fields. And so that was a really interesting thing to me. And so I started off in my book, and I felt like this real jerk, because I'd be talking to people, and I'd be like, is any of you, but have you considered this? And I felt like some people kind of, I think, viewed me like I was trying to come take down their science, which was not my intent at all. And I wanted to say that I think that sports scientists are really good scientists, and they're you know, there are very good reasons for why sports science is done the way that it is. It's extremely difficult to get sample sizes, particularly if you're looking at elite athletes. It can be hard to do, but there are like technical reasons why it's not easy to fix some of these problems. But at that point, no one was really looking at it. But then I did find this one guy who was talking all about p-values and how terrible they were, and I got really excited until I took a closer look at his, he had like basically invented this new statistics, and I started looking at it, and I'm no statistician, but I thought, this doesn't make any sense at all. This seems kind of nonsensical, but I'm not a statistician, so I better. So I sent it off to a bunch of statisticians, and about half of them initially said, this is nonsense, like this is like conspiracy theory. Like they didn't even want to like address it or talk about it because they felt like even just discussing it wasn't worth, it was sort of like the Flat Earth Society, like I'm not gonna bother to debunk it because it's just such nonsense. But I found a statistician at Stanford, Kristen Sanini, who is also a runner. She was really interested in this field. She's also a science writer. She teaches a science writing class at Stanford. So I got her really interested in it, and she got so riled up about it. I was just writing my story, but she got so riled up about it that she actually wrote a paper and published it in a very major sports science journal, basically debunking this methodology and showing why it was wrong. And so basically what the methodology did was made it much easier to find a positive result. So it was basically increasing the false positive rate by a lot, and so which was part of the reason it was probably so appealing to people, but it was also, you know, making the field less rigorous. So anyway, she did that, and this was interesting. So then after that, the this flagship journal in that field actually banned that statistical method. So this is something like, you know, journalists going in and asking questions, you know, really was able to like make a positive change here in the science. And I can't take all the credit for it. I mean, I got Kristen interested. I showed her this and she did the stuff. So it wasn't just me, but it sort of started this thing. And then this other really cool thing happened, which is this is and it was mostly young people, which is really interesting. I've seen this. This is also true a lot in psychology, that it's kind of the younger up and coming researchers that are really most interested in a lot of this stuff, and probably because they're going to be, you know, having to deal with it in their careers, whereas the people that have already made it, they've sort of had their success based on the way things are done now, so very resistant to change. But they formed this thing called STORC, Society for Transparency, Openness, and Replication in Kinesiology. I can't take any credit for this, although a couple of them did tell me that, you know, reading all the work that I did, I sort of helped their thinking on this. But basically, so there's a movement now in sports science to address some of this stuff and to think about it and to do some things differently. And so that's kind of exciting. And again, I think this is really a sign of science working and doing its job. And this isn't a sign that science is broken. It's a sign that it's working as it should. And so I just want to finish up by saying, so I'm a journalist and my job is to discuss, you know, and translate this stuff for the public. And I've like all of this has really made me think long and hard, like how should we be discussing science with the public? Yeah, and my book is a large part of this. So, you know, people are buying it thinking they're gonna find out whether they should do foam rolling and whether icing really works and what electrolytes are, and they will learn all of those things. But I hope that they will also come away with sort of an understanding of how science works and how to assess scientific claims and things like this. But I think one of the most important things that we can help the public understand is that uncertainty is an inherent part of the scientific process, and that is when you see something that's uncertain or where you see something where it's not absolutely positive, that doesn't mean that science is unreliable. It doesn't mean that it's untrustworthy. You know, you hear a lot about, well, is coffee good today or bad today? And I think some of the thinking on this, I mean, part of it is I wrote a whole story for 538 about how nutritional research is just really unreliable by nature, and there's some really interesting reasons for why that is. It's not just that the researchers are bad. What the public has, I think that we tend to encourage this sort of attitude among the public that science is a magic wand that touches everything, that turns everything it touches to truth. And I think this is a really dangerous idea because it basically conveys this idea that science is about absolutes and that we know things or we don't, when really it's this process of uncertainty reduction. And so if you think that science is like spitting out things that are true or false, every time a finding gets overturned, or, you know, my book is riddled with stories of things where, you know, initially the best science said this, but then we did some more science and now it turns out, you know, so they used to think that it was really, really important that right after exercise you had to eat something right away. There was this recovery window. It was really important. It had to be this very specific ratio of like carbs to protein. And, you know, they did subsequent studies, and it turns out that a lot of those findings were sort of a relic of the way that the methodology was done as they kept interrogating this and kept asking questions and seeing, okay, under what circumstances does this hold up? It turned out that it wasn't this narrow recovery window. It was more like a barn door. And, you know, you could, yes, you needed to eat something after exercise, but it could be, you could wait till the next meal and you would really be okay. But, you know, this erroneous, and look, at the time it was the best science we had, but that spurred this whole, like, industrial complex of products that are marketed along with this anxiety that people have that, oh my God, there's this, it's really important, you have to get it exactly right or everything will be off. And that's just not true. But I think that helping people understand that, you know, we may think one thing, and, you know, the thing that we're hearing from the latest study is just, it's, that's what we know now. And that's, you always have to be open to new change. And so I think that the message that we should be conveying is that science is an incremental process of uncertainty reduction, and that there is no finish line. We can never say, okay, now we know everything. You always have to be, I mean, the scientific mindset is always open to new evidence. It has to be. But that's, we're humans, like, we're not good at that. And also, like, the human brain just hates uncertainty. We really, really hate it. And so it's like we're fighting our own human nature. And scientists are not special in this way. Like, scientists are just as vulnerable to this stuff as anyone else. I think it's worth recognizing that. The other thing that I think is really dangerous, so I wrote a story for 538 about this, is that if people don't understand that uncertainty is inherent in it, this really opens them up to vested interests. This is the whole tobacco scenario where it's like, oh, we have this, you know, there's still a little bit of uncertainty about this. We don't know this for sure. Like, we can't say this with absolute certainty, therefore it's all wrong, and we can't say no. You know, this sort of idea that there's sound science or there's good science or there's bad science, it really sort of sets us up for falling prey to hucksters. And also, you know, vested interests that have, you know, have an interest in tearing down inconvenient findings. I mean, this is what happens with climate deniers, right? Like, they can find that we know that climate change is happening, we know that we're causing it. There's still all sorts of uncertainties, but those uncertainties don't mean that the science is wrong, and people need to understand this side of the process if they're not going to be vulnerable about it. I mean, I think the other thing it's really important to know is just that, you know, science is almost always wrong on the way to being right. So it's like, it's not, if I was talking to someone the other day, and we were talking about, like, actually, this was at a conference, and a guy raised his hand and said, you know, let's just do a thought experiment and go, like, 100 years in the future. Which things that we think now are going to hold out and will still be thought right? And we started, there was a conversation there, but then me and some panelists were talking about it later and thinking, you know, if you go out far enough, probably all of it or a lot of it will be wrong, not because we're terrible and we're dumb now, but it's just that's how science works. And, you know, for some of these things, it can take a long time to get a lot of certainty on this. So these are just a few thanks here. I'm going to stop there so I can take questions, but I want to really thank the Santa Fe Institute for having me. This has really started to feel like my intellectual home, so really appreciate the invitation to come back.
Yeah.
Everyone was a beer drinker. Yeah, that was sort of, it was funny. It was very easy to recruit people, actually. Yeah, Chris.
I want to mention, I don't know if you've looked at this, but one area where there's a lot of really shoddy statistics is in predictive policing.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Both political motives and profit motives.
Yeah.
View certain things as both sophisticated and accurate.
Right.
And they're neither in most cases.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's a really good, that's a really important issue. And this is also something that has to do also with all these algorithms, too, that are being used all over our lives where things are just, we're sort of, I think we're at a moment where, I mean, the good thing is people really do trust science and they trust numbers and things, but sometimes, you know, not questioning where those things came from. And I have a whole chapter in my book about this whole movement to try and find called the magic metric, like some number that you can do on your sports watch or something that will tell you whether you're recovered or how hard you should go for your next workout. And it turns out there is no such number, but we're so primed, like, we just think that the thing that you can measure always trumps some sort of qualitative measure. And it turns out that with recovery, the very best measure of that, the very best sort of sign, if you're trying to look for a sign of whether you're recovered from, you know, your hard training, it's mood. And when you think about it, it actually makes some sense, because mood is you know, governed by your brain, which you can almost think of as like this really sophisticated algorithm that's taking all of these inputs, all these physiological and environmental inputs, and putting them together in this like sensation of how you're feeling. And so it's not ridiculous to think that that could be the powerful thing, but no one wants, like, no one really wants to look at that. They want the number.
I'm also, if I could just follow up, even in what I view as kind of the well-educated part of the press, I still read sentences like, this algorithm is twice as accurate as humans.
Right.
Or this algorithm is 90% accurate.
No.
These sentences are meaningless. They're not
yeah.
even grammatical.
Right. Yeah, they're absolutely.
Couldn't agree more. Anything about what types of errors it makes. But to be fair, kind of like the p-value, there's a significant overhead to ask a journalist to actually unpack that sentence and explain what it does mean and what it doesn't.
Yeah.
And like that would be the entire story, actually. I mean, it's not something that, so is that, I don't know, how do you as a journalist, I mean, I think in forums like 538, you really have a lot of freedom to
yeah.
say what you want to say.
Well, it could be hard. And the other thing, I think a real challenge is that people want an answer. And if the answer is, we're really uncertain, we don't know, like no one, well, just tell me what to do. You know, people tell me that, tell me what to do. And But the thing that's interesting is you could have this uncertainty, and we make decisions in the face of uncertainty all the time, right? But when it comes to some of these things, we're looking to science to like tell us what to do. And I think this goes along with my idea that we need to sort of change the way that we're looking at science. But also, I think very importantly, change our expectation of what it can give us and what it can deliver. And so if we expect that science will always give us the final answer. So if you look at a lot of these, a lot of controversies that involve science, they're never really about the science itself. And the science sort of gets roped in as a way of like people picking, you know, trying to take the science to support their side, but usually those controversies are actually about value judgments that need to be made about the science. So like if you look at climate change, a lot of the controversy and a lot of what is going on is people, you know, we have to decide what to do about it. And that's a value judgment. Those are ethical questions, those are moral questions. These are not things that science can answer. Science can tell you if you do this, this is what we think will happen. You know, this might be the road, but they can't tell us like what is the best thing to do, and there are trade-offs in every situation. I was just at this conference about science communication, and someone was talking about they had been in Puerto Rico during the Zika outbreak, and there was an area they were wanting to spray for mosquitoes, and people were in uproar about not wanting the spraying because they were worried about health effects and things from the spraying. And so, you know, and this one scientist was saying, they're so dumb, and like, they're just anti-science. And I thought, you know, those are value judgments because you have two different sets of risks, and maybe the science says that one is much greater than the other, but on an individual basis, those values may differ. And I think that's one place that communicators of science need to be really, you know, open to listening to people's concerns and recognizing that science so often is not providing the answer. It can only inform those decisions. Yeah, your turn.
Oh.
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. Whose job is it? And I don't have, I mean, I think it's a really important answer that doesn't have like an immediately obvious answer. I mean, I think, yeah, you can say, well, we need to do a better job of educating people in schools. I know there's a lot of movement now to try and help with science literacy in classrooms and things to help. So not just teaching kids about science, but teaching kids how to evaluate evidence and how to sort of think critically, which is probably, when you think about it, like teaching people critical thinking is probably, you know, it's better to give them this tool than they can take everything in rather than teaching them specific facts. The general public, I don't know. I mean, we have all these programs now of doing fact checking. I mean, you can look on the Washington Post and see how many lies President Trump has told. You know, is that changing people's mind? Is that helping them? I don't know, it's really difficult. And I think one of the challenges here is that so often in these things, what you have, particularly with issues that are polarized, is that in some cases, these things can become almost badges of identity groups. So I'm a conservative, therefore I have to believe this, or I'm a liberal, therefore my team's saying that. And so people aren't really even evaluating the evidence. Dan Kahan at Yale has done some really interesting research on this, basically showing that some of the most partisan folks on climate change know, they actually know a lot about climate change, but they're sort of just the most, and they're, people who are really well-educated and well-informed are really, really good at motivated reasoning, too. You've probably done some research on this, too, Mirta. And so, yeah, they're actually the best at being able to, like, twist the evidence to support their views. And so I don't think there are any really good, easy answers.
Yeah. So I'm curious on a more narrow scale. When you started unpacking the results from your study, did your investigator follow up on some of the questions? I mean, whether, you know, I'm intrigued by the gender differences.
Yeah.
And I'm, you know, and you mentioned resilience, and you know, that's one hypothesis is resilience factor. I'm wondering if he's done follow-up.
I have a meeting with them next week. We're trying to plan. They have an undergrad who's going to do as a thesis project a follow-up study. So we're trying to kind of figure out, okay, what did we learn here? Like, what are the things to like interrogate on the next study, and what are the sort of shortcomings? Like, one of them obviously being the study design of, you know, moving it so the tests aren't right in a row, but there are a lot of things like that. Hopefully, you know, by this time next year we'll have some better answers, but we won't have the answer. Yeah.
I'm wondering what your advice is for scientists like us to talk to science writers
field, genetics, and I feel that this move from this correlation, this uncertainty, into this is answer is happening there when you show some correlation and then the science paper, there's the science article says the gene for X is found.
Yeah.
So how do we maintain this kind of integrity in trying to communicate this to the science writer and convince them that those kind of titles might be enticing, but just wrong?
Yeah, well, I think I should let you all know that usually the editors, not the writers, write the headlines, which it really sucks. And I think that you're right, headlines like that are misleading. But I think the important thing is to really take the time. So one thing is like talk to journalists. I know sometimes scientists are hesitant to talk to journalists. And like that's the worst thing. If you're worried that your research is going to be misrepresented, the worst thing you can do is not talk to the journalists, because that's your chance to like get it right. But I think just really laying out what those uncertainties are, but also thinking long and hard, like what should the message to the public be? And if the public is wondering, you know, what is the answer, like what how would you answer that? Like imagine there's this whole like, imagine you're at a cocktail party, you're talking to someone who's not a scientist, how would you explain it to them? I think one of the most important things that a scientist can do talking to a journalist is sort of avoid jargon and help them, like help me explain it to a lay audience. If there's an analogy you can use that's helpful, that's always really good, particularly for complex things. Is there some sort of story or something that will help to explain it? And how would you explain, you know, the uncertainties or the things that, you know, need follow-up? Like, and how do you fit that into the greater story? And these are things that you can think of ahead of time and explain. I mean, you can basically feed to the journalist what they can say. So it's a chance for you to do that.
Can I ask that same question, but for a communications person? Because we often try to get ahead of studies by putting out the sort of what we think are the main findings,
yeah,
then that gets sort of twisted. So is there things that PIOs can do to ensure the right message is getting out there? I mean, like, is it appropriate, for example, to write a reporter and say, you kind of got this wrong, which I've done before with mixed results, so what would you advise?
Yeah, no, I think it's totally fine to do. I would encourage you to do that. I mean, you want to be nice about it. I mean, you want to be respectful, but yeah, I mean, that doesn't happen very often, but I have had people come to me and say I got something wrong, and I want to know that. And first of all, like, I'll make a correction if it's something correctable. And you know, it's interesting. Oftentimes, when a source doesn't like the story, it's because I didn't tell the story they wanted to tell. So it's not incorrect. It's just that they wanted their study highlighted more. Or they wanted it to be about this thing, but I think that my readers are more interested in another aspect of it. But I think just writing, you know, making sure to have in that press release the real takeaway that you want journalists to use and to write about. I'm sure you're not one of them, but there are studies that showing that a lot of the hype and like things that are like overly hyping things and sort of oversimplifying things actually come both from press releases from institutions, but also from the journals themselves. So it's like there's a lot of blaming of journalists, and look, there's a lot of blame to go around, but sometimes it, yeah, and there's a lot of incentives for institutions to hype things too. So I think some of it is all of us just taking a step back and saying, okay, we're not going to do that, which can be hard because there's a lot of pressure, right? Yeah.
So, I mean, I totally agree with what you're saying. I think that scientists for a long time have been really afraid of being wrong, of being caught wrong. And so, for example, in evolutionary biology, right, the idea of, if we show that maybe mutations are like this or like that, then creationism will happen.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of fear from that in many fields. And I totally agree that you will be wrong, right?
So yeah.
You should warn ahead. But the question is, okay, so you kind of presented it from the point of view of the science writer, you say.
Mm-hmm.
The science writer has to explain to the public that it's not really written on stone.
Yeah.
To change. But how, from the scientist's point of view, should we be like not afraid to put things out and put in our fears that we're wrong? Or, and also from the side of the public, like let's say that the public is told global warming is coming. And how can the public assess how much it should trust that? And like, if we're not saying we're right, if we're saying, well, the current scientific theory, we might be wrong, we don't know in what way. Like, how should the public think?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think some of it comes down to, so with something like with climate change, global warming, we know it's happening. Like there's a lot, there's actually a lot of certainty, and we can go back. I mean, we've made predictions. We can go back and look at how those predictions panned out, and most of them have performed pretty well. So we know we're on the right track. So there are some things that we're really quite certain about, and then there are other things where there's less certainty. And so I think framing things in those sorts of terms. So like in the big picture, we're very certain about this. For specific things, we can't tell you with exact confidence how warm it's going to be in 40 years. We can say with pretty good confidence that if we stay on this trajectory, if we continue emitting at this, you know, in this kind of timeline, but there are all sorts of things we can't predict. Is there a big volcano? Is there a recession? So the last sort of big dip in emissions was really, it wasn't because we all decided to be, you know, that we were gonna do something, it was because the economy tanked. So actually maybe what we really need is a huge global recession, and that will help things. I don't mean that seriously, but it would, you know. So there's just a lot of it's a very complex system. And I think maybe explaining some of that complexity could help. But this also goes back to this idea that if the public's saying, well, it's either true or it's false, and everything about it's true or false, like we just have to get away from that kind of thinking. And the more that we can explain things in more nuanced terms, so you're still having the big picture, you know, the top line, global warming's happening, it's happening now, it's not theoretical, like we can measure it. It's been happening for the last decade. It's been happening in the last few years. Like we have demonstrable evidence of that. At the same time, there's some things that we're less certain about, and we can talk about that.
Thank you.
All right, thanks everyone.